am here in this beautiful town called Bolinao in Pangasinan. It is up north, the main island of Luzon in the Philippines. And I had the privilege of meeting and talking to Chef Stries Casallo, who is behind the MunchLab. The MunchLab is a cloud kitchen that is changing the way food business is being done here in this town. Learn about his inspiration and how the pandemic has actually become the push that turned his idea into fruition. Our conversation got deeper when we talked about his experiences growing up as a Filipino-American who eventually came back to his roots here in the Philippines. Learn about his views on how OFWs can resurface as the new heroes in the country's economic recovery. So, what are we waiting for? Let's talk! Chef Stries is the chef behind, the MunchLab, which is one of my favorite go-to places for good food, or actually great food here in Bolinao. So, hi Chef, good afternoon.
Hi Joyce, how are you?
I'm good, and how about you?
Well, Mondays are day off, so I'm doing everything I can to take a day off, but I'm in the kitchen, so it's never really a day off for me.
Yeah, and I know that you are in your kitchen, right?
Yes, I'm actually here in the MunchLab right now.
All right. Well, okay.
So, unfortunately, I don't have food for you. But.
Well, thank you for making time for this quick coffee break chat. And yeah, hopefully we get to share a bit about your business there. So yeah, I've been very interested about the concept behind the MunchLab. Maybe you can share about it to our followers at Coffee with Joyce.
Okay, sure. So the MunchLab, the way I look at it, it's like a virtual food park. And the idea is born actually out of a cloud kitchen concept. Cloud kitchens have been around for about 2 or 3 years now. And they're actually starting to spring up here in the Philippines, one of the more notable cloud kitchen concepts here in the Philippines. Is actually Grab Kitchen, which I think they opened up in Makati, but they already operate Grab Kitchens in I think Singapore, and they brought it over to Manila. And so there's a few other cloud kitchens. I think I'm probably one of the I don't know, first in the province actually that's operating anything like it. So this. That's what the MunchLab really is, and the idea is I'd like to be able to bring in not just my concepts, but other restaurant concepts. So if I can get with other food entrepreneurs or other chefs who would like to start some sort of restaurant, but they don't have the capital, they don't have the resources, but they want to see if their concept works, and then we can work out a deal and have my staff be trained according to their standards and their menu and push it out for them and see how it works for them. So right now, the MunchLab, I think if you notice, we have a few concepts in here that are working right now. We've got the Hawaiian restaurant, which is the Uno Brines Hawaiian Barbecue. A lot of people ask me, like, you know, what does that mean? I guess you have to be familiar with Hawaiian pidgin talk. Uno means delicious in local Hawaiian pidgin speak, and then grinds is eat, so it's delicious. It's delicious food. That's what it means. So there's one. There's the Korean, the K-pop district, the Chinese American concept, actually, which is walking the eight. A lot of people don't realize that there's actually a difference between, you know, the Chinese food you get in Binondo and the Chinese food you get in San Francisco. They're very rooted in Chinese cuisine, of course, but because of the different communities and different ingredients that they cater with and cater to, there's a little bit of difference in the style of cooking and also the presentation of these foods. And then, of course, my personal favorite, the Fat and Slims, which is the American fast food that's chefed up, I guess, in a way. Mm-hmm. And I've only been releasing the hot dogs in there, or the hamburgers, actually, mm-hmm. and I haven't released actually the hot dogs yet, but you've been able to enjoy some of the hamburgers. So that's really like right now what's going on for the MunchLab in terms of what the concept is. It's I don't want people to think of it as like, oh, you know, what does the MunchLab have to offer today? I like to be able to like pick out a restaurant within the MunchLab and say, you know, I feel like Hawaiian today. I feel like Chinese. I feel like Korean. Or I feel like Mexican. I forgot I have tacos machachos in there also, which is rooted in my experience in growing up with a lot of Mexicans. So that's where that idea and a lot of those recipes come from.
All right. Okay. I picked up two things there. And the first one is, you talked about concept a great deal, like
yes.
As you were talking, right? And I'm curious about how does one approach you with, let's say, a food concept? Like, are you
sure.
just open to anybody, or are they basically your friends, or are these like entirely your concept?
Some of them are partnered up. You know, I've got this. The MunchLab is actually operating as a corporation, and mm-hmm. it's a few entrepreneurs that have come together. A lot of the menus and recipes have been created by me based on what their concepts are. So, I mean, there's a few other concepts in the works right now. There's a piece of concept, of course, that's in place, which is where my wings are going to be part of, and also my pasta. So it's going to be a pizza, pasta, and wings. And then there's a Indo-Chinese cuisine. During the lockdown, the first few months of the pandemic, you know, a lot of us shut down, and we were pretty much relegated to cooking in our own home kitchens, you know, without a staff to help us out. And then as things eased up a little bit, I was able to bring back some of my staff and start putting together some of these dishes. And one of those dishes was pad thai and pho and Vietnamese food. And so, and that really worked out really well. Actually, but it's just that I haven't pushed it out yet in MunchLab, even though the names have been trademarked and registered. So, but like as far as like people approaching me, other people besides the partners I have already, I'm really open to that. Right now, we do have the Indian food. I don't actually cook that. That's actually done by another kitchen that we sell for. And the kitchen's actually in Alaminos. So they're, you know, they're about 45 minutes away, and we use the MunchLab as kind of a delivery system for them also. So that's the other part, is that there's a delivery component to it. So what, instead of spending money on the resources that, you know, buying tables and chairs and maintaining dining furniture, and then also having to allocate resources towards front of house operations like servers and greeters and bussers, I've removed a lot of that expense and focused mostly on the kitchen, the back of house, and also logistics. And then we share these resources with other food entrepreneurs who want to bring in their concepts, but they don't have the resources to set up their own restaurant, but they want to incubate the idea. And so that's the best word I can think of as far as the other purpose of MunchLab internally is it's a restaurant incubator. And so I hope that other food entrepreneurs, if they'd like to, I invite them, you know, incubate your idea with us and let's see if we can make it work for you. And then if the idea works, if it works virtually and works online through a delivery system, and if there's enough call for it, and if things, you know, change within this environment that we have right now with the pandemic and dining is a little bit more acceptable, and maybe it's a concept that we can turn it into its own standalone dine-in restaurant.
So I can see that two kinds of people approach MunchLab. So you have your customers who order food, and you have the food entrepreneurs who have either their concepts or exactly their food that they want to have, I don't know, shared, is that the proper term, to the MunchLab so that you can deliver it to the regular.
I didn't catch that last part. Sorry.
Oh, yeah. So, yeah, the second kind of people who walk into MunchLab are the food entrepreneurs. And these food entrepreneurs are the ones who would like to have their food concepts tested in your kitchen and probably deliver it to your consumers. Is that right?
Yes. Yes. So the other thing, too, is with health and safety as a big concern with a lot of people right now, something that we've also looked into is providing a facility that is within food safety standards. So let's say a small-time online seller, you know, they'd like to take it to another level, what they've been doing. And if things start to get strict a little bit, we have the venue for them to be able to produce their foods. And so right now our space is small and confined a little bit, but you know, when people here in town, because this is not that big of a town, but it's still pretty big. This is a first class municipality. You know, they heard that we were doing it here. They're wondering if we were going to do dine in, and when they realized there was no dine in, and they take a look inside the window, the whole place is a kitchen. I mean, you've stopped by, you've seen that the whole bottom floor is rented out. It's basically just for kitchen space. And so we hope to provide that kitchen space also to other food entrepreneurs if they wish. That's still very later on into what you'd like to develop into. So for now, it's just incubating the ideas that we started during the first few months of the pandemic when we were doing everything online selling individually. So
Well, it seems to me that you have quite a network of food entrepreneurs here in Pangasinan. I'm curious about how were you able to connect with them?
Well, some of them, like one of my partners, Jen, she started out as one of my customers. And she has a heavy front of house experience from overseas. And she was looking to starting a restaurant also. And she had approached me for another idea. And then the MunchLab, this space opened up, and so then we got to talking and decided let's do this instead. And so I told her what my ideas and actually it's this whole cloud kitchen concept. I didn't just think of it to implement it just during the pandemic. It's actually been a year in the works. I don't know if you know this or if you've heard around town, but I actually had a physical restaurant on the other side of the town, Bolinao, at one of the resorts here. And I had decided to move my restaurant out of there, and I was hoping to turn it into a cloud kitchen, because one of the things that was really killing me having it inside a resort is that the labor requirements was really keeping my bottom line. Like, no matter how much revenue I was picking up, to operate in a resort, in any kind of hotel, it's one of the most difficult restaurant ventures, actually, because you've got to try to, if your strong hours are during the nighttime operation, but the hotel requires you to have labor from morning until midnight, a lot of your nighttime revenues is going to pay up, trying to pay the rest of the day when you barely you don't have much revenue. So for me, it was a bad situation. I got out of it, and I was trying to create a cloud kitchen, and a few things happened along the way, and then the pandemic happened. And so the pandemic, I think what it did was it helped me speed up the idea, because it became a necessity now to have your food delivered. And it made dining in almost, at the moment, obsolete. I don't know how it'll come back. I see some of it's starting to come back already, which is great, because front of house still needs employment. And even though for me, my front of house employment has switched over to the logistics.
Okay. You had a concept already, like of the cloud kitchen, long before you decided to move out of your physical space, right?
Yes.
So, just a little curious about how did you know that it was time to finally let go of the physical space?
I started reading a little bit more about it, and one of the you know, we talk about what kind of inspires you, what kind of triggers you to move forward with these kinds of ideas. One of them was reading about grad kitchen coming to the Philippines, and I said, okay, so it's true that, you know, Grab and Angkas, you know, they're doing a lot of food deliveries already, and that's in Manila though. So my idea is actually great for Manila, but I'm here in the province because the first restaurant was part of the resort here. So that's what brought me over to Bolinao. Even though I do have family roots in Bolinao, it's not just it's kind of a serendipitous actually move, because it's actually my fiance who got me over here. It wasn't me. And so I said, oh, wow. So I'm going to go back to Bolinao, where I haven't lived at since I was 2 years old.
Okay. So yeah, because I wanted to ask, what made you settle in Bolinao? So it's all about your fiance.
This was 3 or 4 years ago. She was working with the marketing side of the resort that our restaurant was at, and she said, hey, you know what, they're building a restaurant there. Well, why don't you pitch an idea? Maybe you can take over that restaurant. And at the time we were living in Manila, you know, she was working from home. She took all the calls for customers from home and did everything from over there. And I said, well, that means that we're gonna have to move to Bolinao. And so we checked it out. I came up with the idea, the concept. The owners of the resort loved it, and so we went with it, and we ended up over here in Bolinao. And you know, sometimes you get familiar to the place, especially when you have roots like I do. I have family roots to this place. I ended up staying even after I decided to leave the resort. So I think if I didn't have any roots here in Bolinao, I might have looked at establishing the MunchLab or a cloud kitchen concept maybe in Clark or Baguio or maybe in Manila. But so I'd stick it out here in Bolinao, just because of the family roots that I have here already.
Talk about family roots. You said that you haven't been here since you were 2 years old, and I think you did stay in the States, in the U.S. for quite some time, right?
Oh, I'm a bona fide Fil-Am. Let's just put it that way. I grew up there. I'm actually a dual citizen. I was born here in the Philippines. I was born in Alaminos, but I was baptized here in Bolinao. And so before I moved to the States, I was pretty much here in Bolinao. My grandma had a business here for a very long time. So a lot of the people here, they recognize my last name, and they immediately put two and two together and say, oh, so you're so-and-so's grandson. I said, yeah, she's my grandma. You know, so that's kind of the cool thing about being in a small town like Bolinao is familiarity. So it wasn't hard for me to adjust to settle into the provincial life, coming from the States, living in LA, and then living in Manila, and then living here in Bolinao.
If you don't mind, what made you stay here in the Philippines or move from LA to Manila and then Bolinao?
Sure. So this was 2015. My parents were coming here for a vacation, and they asked me, hey, do you want to come with us? I said, yeah, sure, I'll come. You know, I haven't been to the Philippines since 2018. Just work and life got in the way. But before that, 2008 was the last time I was here. And from 2008, before that, I was pretty much going to the Philippines every two, every 3 years since I turned 18. And then 2008 happened, and I just stopped coming back here. I just work, life and work got in the way. And so 2015, I had a chance. I had, you know, my boss at the time said, yeah, go ahead. You know, you need a break. So I came here for 3 weeks. And when I came back, I said, I want to go back to the Philippines. I think I can do some stuff there. I want to bring some of my knowledge, my resources, and see what I can do to help out the economy there. And, you know, maybe I can inspire other Fil-Ams to invest and bring their resources also to the Philippines. Because one of the things I notice here is that we're heavily dependent on OFWs and the remittances. And a lot of the economy is driven by that. I think what's missing at this point is the transition of some of these OFWs, more OFWs, into entrepreneurs. And if maybe the government or somebody can help with that kind of transition, to make it happen for OFWs to start up businesses. And I think part of it also is teaching a little bit more financial literacy and responsibility to OFWs, because they're bringing in the dough into the country and it's helping out our economy. But at some point, they're going to have to become the employers and create the jobs here in the Philippines. Because if you look at the United States, 70% of all jobs there come from small businesses. I was employed for many years by small business. I never did. You know, I grew up and lived in Seattle before I lived in LA, but I didn't work for any of the big corporations like Starbucks or Boeing. My brother-in-law works for Boeing, but I always worked for small businesses. And I can say most of my friends are the same also. My brother-in-law is the only one I know that worked for a big, large company, Boeing. You know, most everybody I know back home in the States works for a small business. And so it's not just about bringing in big companies to invest in the Philippines, but it's also about the smaller people, because they're the ones that have more connection with their communities when they come home and they decide to invest and create jobs here and create businesses and help drive the economy and move it into that direction, so that we're not just heavily dependent on a thriving gross national product, but that we also have a good gross domestic product.
Thank you for pointing that out. You know, it's very timely because of the pandemic, a lot of OFWs suddenly find themselves jobless. And yes, they are usually the breadwinners. So exactly. What's in it, right? Mm-hmm. And so, well, this is another, yeah, go ahead.
It's interesting because I notice a lot of these OFWs, they are online sellers now. Yeah, a lot of cruise ship workers that I know, seamen, the merchant marines, domestic helpers that I know of, they're online selling. And so now they're kind of forced into that entrepreneurial role that I'm hoping that they would, you know, more OFWs would turn to eventually. It's just they're forced into it. I'd like to see it gradual, so a little bit more gradual, where they actually do save up their monies and spend a little bit more wisely when they're sending it home, and create more efficient businesses that actually do employ more people. Because at this point, they're into business for themselves to try to survive, wait it out. They're waiting out the pandemic.
Well, there are a couple of Filipino-Americans who I have met recently who maybe share the same story, like my host here, Michael. He did move.
Yes, Michael. Right? Michael.
Yes, we've been having conversations here. And yeah, he just is basically like you. He was raised in the States also. And for some reason, he chose to come back here in the Philippines and set up his own business. And I think he shares pretty much the same philosophy as now. Okay, if we are going to, let's say, let this story be heard by fellow Filipino-Americans like might be living comfortable lives where they are right now. What do you think were like the things that you experienced in the States that helped you prepare for this move here?
One of the things is, and I always say this with my, especially like the top core of my kitchen staff, the sous chefs and the chefs, is that, look, anybody in the Philippines can do what I do. The only advantage I have is that I've been exposed. You know, I've been exposed to these foods. I'm exposed to the flavors, the taste. And so this is just the only difference. I mean, for me, one of the things that I'd like to accomplish with the MunchLab being here in Bolinao, because Bolinao is very tourism dependent. And so because it's heavily tourism dependent, the economic activity at this point is very low. But when it does pick up, I'm hoping that my foods can also change their standard of catering to the international tourists. Because what I notice with you know, some of these other tourist spots like Boracay or even La Union is that the food is a little bit more catered to international travelers. I think I'm getting off subject here. What was I talking about? Preparing Fil-Ams to come here and do something like this, I'd say take what you learn over there. Your experiences, not just your money and your resources, but also your experiences and also the work habits. Because one of my challenges of having employees here in the province is that they just don't have the same mindset sometimes as what we expect, either working in Manila or employing also in the States. And so you've got to be a little bit more patient with them. You can't expect a 100% turnaround of their attitudes and their work habits. So it does require a little bit more patience. It requires a lot more patience with dealing with the government also. And it's not the easiest place to start a business. I mean, I could be here in the Philippines and not even be an American citizen and set up a business, a corporation within a week in America by sitting here in my laptop without having to visit or fall in line anywhere. And I wish something like that could happen here in the Philippines also. And, you know, that's going to be a long ways for now, but I'd like for them to take that in consideration that, hey, if you want economic activity, you also got to make it easier for us to start economic activity, because if you want these businesses registered, make it easier for us to register. And then the taxes will roll in because we're registered. You know, so for Fil-Ams, I'd say bring your resource, bring your knowledge, and pass that knowledge on. You got to become a big brother. And you can't look down on the people over here just because, you know, they've grown up differently, and you can't really try to force your cultural standards that you grew up with in the States. You know, the Western mindsets. You have to remember we are still a Southeast Asian country with Southeast Asian cultural values, and you got to find the middle ground to meld both of those together as a Fil-Am or as any westernized Filipino.
Yes, that's what, thank you also for pointing that out, because a lot of people who come here, they think that, oh, I have all these great ideas and I'm just gonna download this to the community and, you know, they're gonna have to accept it because my idea is great. Nonetheless, it's good that you mentioned that we have to find a middle ground. And I'm yes. just interested as well to learn, how were you able to find that middle ground, being, you know, a westernized Filipino who has roots here, and somehow you have to with workers who have this different mindset. So how were you able to do that?
Well, one of the things that doesn't change no matter what, whether you're here in the Philippines or if you're a Filipino overseas, is your idea of a family, that's not going to change. And so that's always my connecting middle ground with my employees and with the people that I work with here, is understanding how the Filipino family works. and you get to you understand them at that point, so you have a connection. You know, it's the titas at the party that's always asking how many girlfriends you have, and you know, telling you you gained weight. That's never going to change, and so you find those things to joke about and have fun with. Because for me, my accent is strong, even though I can speak Ilocano fluently, but there's still a little bit of accent there sometimes. That's one of my connections over here. Is, you know, that's something that, of course, I learned growing up, because my parents never spoke to us in English. Growing up in America, they always spoke to us in Ilocano, so we never forgot it. And so I use Ilocano all the time, of course. And then knowing how the family, Filipino family, functions and works, you're able to connect your workers that way. You're able to ask questions that are relevant to that. You're able to come up with ideas for your restaurant or whatever business you're trying to come up with based on that. You know, how does the Filipino family function? And where is it? What drives it to act that way?
Wonderfully said.
Thank you.
Yes, you're right that, you know, one of the things that remains consistent among all Filipinos, regardless of where we are, is how we interact with each other as family. And even, like, let's say for those who work in big corporations, let's say in Manila or in BGC, Makati, we can see the difference between family-owned corporations and those that are, let's say, multinationals. Yeah. We all see that Filipino family touch and are owned by Filipinos here. So there, thank you so much for sharing a bit of your time and, of course, your stories and all your thoughts with me over coffee. So,
my pleasure.
Yeah. Yes, and finally, what's next for Chef Stries?
Well, during my time, you know, here in the Philippines, I've been able to connect and meet other chefs, a few celebrity chefs also. So, I've been asked to collaborate. You know, so there's just collaborations in the works. I am looking to promote Pangasinense cuisine. We don't have a Pangasinense menu right now in the MunchLab, but that is something that we are working to develop and create, because when I put it out, I want it to be correct, because I want it to be also, you know, that's something that the visitors to Bolinao can appreciate. So that's one of the things I look forward to is pushing Pangasinense cuisine. I mean, everybody's familiar with Bicolano and Kapampangan and Ilonggo cuisine through various restaurants and chefs, but there's not a lot said about Pangasinense cuisine. You know, not a lot said about this melding of cuisines that's kind of stuck in the middle between the Ilocano foods and the Central Luzon food ideas. But you've been here, you've seen some of the stuff that we do here that's unique, like the binongay. I'm pretty sure you've come across the binongay. There's a couple other desserts that we do here. I don't know if you've come across pigar pigar. That's one of, like, our major pulutan here in Pangasinan, actually. It goes very well with another Pangasinan dish called kaleskes. So that's one of the things I hope to do when the pandemic ends. I've got a few restaurant friends also back in the States, and we've been talking maybe actually for the last 2 or 3 years now about me coming back over there to do a quick pop-up kitchen and to present Pangasinense and also Ilocano cuisine for a pop-up night. So, because the foods in the restaurants, the Filipino restaurants in America, they're pretty much, I'd say, centralized around Kapangpangan cuisine. I mean, it's the most recognizable of all the Filipino cuisines. But like I said, there's not enough said yet about northern dishes. And with my fiance also being Ilongga, that's something also I'd like to try to promote over there also, because I've dabbled into some of her dishes, like kansi and the bachoy. So it's something I'd like to be able to promote, not just Filipino food in general, but regionalized sets of Filipino foods. Because if you go to, like, other types of restaurants in America, you come across, you know, Northern Mexican and Southern Mexican, and Tex-Mex and Cal-Mex type Mexican restaurants. But when it comes to Filipino, it's just Filipino. It's all jumbled into just one.
Yeah, my connection is starting to act up, but I did quite get what you said for the most part. It's regionalizing Filipino dishes, which I think is about time that we actually promote not just Filipino dishes, but, you know, what does the Ilocanos have to offer? And more specifically, in your case, what's unique with the Pangasinan or maybe even Bolinao food, right? So thank you so much again for your time, Chef Stries. Definitely, I'll order more before I leave Bali now.
Yes. Oh, yeah, we should. Yeah.
All right. Let me just end this broadcast.